Happening right now, lawmakers in Raleigh are debating something that's going to impact you for the next decade. The General Assembly is expected to vote soon on a map that changes our state's congressional district boundaries. Remember, your representation in Congress impacts you every day. It influences how much you pay in taxes, what kind of roads you have, and how good your child's education is. The congressional maps have to be redrawn every 10 years after the new census data comes out showing where everyone lives. And here's how things look right now. With Greensboro, Winston-Salem, and High Point all in the same district, represented by Democrat Kathy Manning. Take a look at the new map, though, proposed by the State Senate Redistricting Committee. This right here splits the triad into three. Greensboro, High Point, and Winston-Salem, all broken up, would have a different representative. The map also splits Guilford County into three different districts. Now, to really get a sense of what this change would be like, let's take that Greensboro district right here. It starts in Greensboro and it wraps up around Winston-Salem, stretches all the way over to the Tennessee border. To drive this right here, it's about a 2.5 hour drive. And to get a sense of what this would really be like, I hopped on a Zoom today with someone who lives in West Jefferson. How much does West Jefferson have in common with Greensboro?
Very little. We're both west of Raleigh.
Here's a little more context for you. Among the small town of West Jefferson's largest industries are selling Christmas trees and tourism. Greensboro's are aviation and manufacturing. West Jefferson is 88% white, Greensboro 47% white. And West Jefferson, they get about 2 feet of snow a year compared to Greensboro's 5 inches.
It's a beautiful place to live, but I mean, I can't see where it has a whole lot in common with Guilford.
The House started debate at 1 p.m. It took a little longer than expected, and the vote may not happen until tomorrow. Two political science professors we spoke with say the House is expected to pass the proposed map. The chair of the House committee in charge of the mapping system says it's fair.
Not only was it the most transparent process in the history of this state, but for the first time in North Carolina history, the legislature adopted a process on our own volition that did not include the use of political data. And given that there was so much litigation with respect to those maps, I took advantage of many of the court cases that we had over the course of the decade that had previously dictated to the General Assembly how to draw these maps.
And then there's State Senator Ralph Hies, who actually drew the map. He says in a statement that reads in part, "The continuing complaints from Democrats and their lawyers show they'll take issue with any maps that don't give Democrats their preferred partisan advantage." A Princeton University group graded the proposed map. They gave it an F. Here's why. They say that it judges the partisan fairness, competitiveness, and geographic features of the map. It gave the map an F for partisan fairness. The group says the map gives Republicans a significant advantage, like 21% over Democrats. The map received a C for competitiveness and geographic features. Now, those scores mean the group thinks the map is similar to other maps nationwide in those categories. Lawmakers held town halls last week before picking a map to vote on. People went and made comments about the proposed maps, and the vast majority of them, they did not support this current version. Some felt it compromised our elections.
If any of these maps are used, we will not have free elections in North Carolina because you have already predetermined the outcome. In Congress, we will have 9 to 12 Republicans out of 14.
This is straight up BS. I say we vote all y'all out, you go home, and that's it.
No surprise, Representative Kathy Manning was not happy. The map makes it harder for her to get elected. She released a very long statement yesterday. You can see right there. Here is part of it. These congressional maps represent an extensive partisan gerrymandering that splits communities of interest, disregards the redistrict criteria set forth by the committee, and shows a callous disinterest for the representation that North Carolinians requested during the public comment periods leading to the vote. She continued, "These maps don't acknowledge that the triad is a region with shared interests, concerns, and needs." We also reached out to Republican leaders in the area, like Representative Virginia Fox. She did not respond to our comments, but we did try to contact her multiple times. Redistricting can get complicated. It happens every 10 years, and a whole lot has to go into it. States gain or lose seats based on their proportion of the U.S. population. In 2020, North Carolina gained a seat. State lawmakers redrew the maps to determine how to split up the now 14 districts. Each district needs about the same number of people, but UNCG political science professors say there's other things that go into making the maps.
And then there are other guidelines that states have to meet in terms of the compactness of the district, the fairness of the district in terms of racial and partisan fairness, the trying to keep communities like communities together as much as possible. But these are all guidelines, and these guidelines often conflict with one another. So it's often a very difficult process to draw district lines, and it's also often a very political process.
All of it sounds familiar, right? That's because in 2019, a panel of judges at the state court said lawmakers had to redraw North Carolina's congressional map and the state house and senate maps. The state court ruled the maps were gerrymandered, giving Republicans an unfair advantage in the 2020 election. Now, gerrymandering happens when one party draws district lines a certain way so they've got a better chance of winning. We spoke to a political science professor at UNCG. He says another court battle is likely here, and it could end up throwing off the whole 2022 election cycle.
The unfortunate part is it's going to be in court. It'll be in court in 2021. By 2022, it'll be heard. It'll delay the elections probably. The primaries are usually made, and it's going to probably push those. And when you do that, you're creating less time for the candidates themselves, the ones who are vying for the general election, less time to campaign and actually get the message out.
He thinks it would also decrease voter turnout, which is already an issue in North Carolina. You know, our state is not alone here. This map from 538 breaks down redistricting across the country. 20 states right now have maps either working through their state houses or they're working on it. Another 16 haven't submitted proposals yet, but they still need to do so before next year's midterm elections. 538 looked at the maps that have already passed. It projects Democrats will gain 7 seats right now. This could all change as many states still have to decide what their maps will look like.